It's a pleasure to be here and have a little talk about our project that is called SEAFARM. And the title is, as you said, Algae Cultivation for a More Sustainable Future, or WORD. I am currently the head of Department of Sustainable Development, Environmental Science and Engineering at KTH, where we are 140 people devoted to sustainable development. And to cultivate algae is actually a very sustainable issue. The project is called SEAFARM, and we are cultivating algae, seaweeds, kelp. There are many names for the same thing. This is a cooperation between KTH, that are the project leader, the Chalmers Technical University in Gothenburg, and Gothenburg University, and Linnaeus University, and Lund's University, and it is funded by the Swedish Research Council, FORMAS. Algae or seaweeds are the new oil, you could say. It's a biomass that is we could cultivate, and you could use it for all the things that you could use fossil biomass like oil or for. And that means that we could do everything that we could do with oil, but we could also eat it, and that is an other advantage by cultivating algae. And I will take you a little bit into this project and show what we are doing. And the first thing I would like to show here is actually the project in a nutshell. The project is big. We are having a lot of other projects around the SEAFARM project, and actually we got funding for more than $10 million for this project. So it's a five-year project, and it's a strategical project for a bio-based economy for the future. The project is divided into different focus areas. And we have five focus areas in the SEAFARM project. The first focus area is that we have to learn how could we cultivate algae in Scandinavian or Swedish water. No one have done this before, so this is completely new. And we have a little bit special situation in the Swedish water. We don't have a tide, and we have a very difficult marine environment. So there is a little bit of a trick to cultivate algae in Swedish water. But this we are doing together with Gothenburg University, and we know the trick now. We could cultivate algae, and we get a really large production of algae biomass in our cultivation site on the west coast of Sweden. So we know that. The next phase in the SEAFARM project is that we need to know how should we handle the algae? What should we do with it? Shall we make it frozen? Should we dry it? What shall we do? How could we store the biomass or preserve it so we could use it when it's not available, when we don't have a harvest? And that is, of course, very important. So a lot of interesting research is around different ways to do this in an economical way. After the storage and preservation, we take the biomass into what we call biorefineries. And the biorefineries are located here at KTH, at the polymer institution at the chemical school here at KTH, and on Chalmers, where we are working with food and feed additives that you could use algae for. And then we are looking into what we could get out from the algae. The algae, you could extract a lot of valuable things because algae could enhance taste in food. So there are taste enhancers. You could make things more stable in the food. And there is already a very big market for algae ingredients in food products. Most of you are eating algae every day, but you don't know it. But whenever you eat an ice cream or you take even a beer and so on, there will be algae ingredients in this thing. You could also extract colors and things that from algae. So there is a lot of things you could do with these algae ingredients. And they are very high value products that you could get a very big price for. But we are also looking into what you could do with them. What could we make with the algae polymers, for example? We know that we could make plastics. We are doing that at KTH already. We know that we could make textiles out of algae. We could also make glue and adhesives for plywood instead of formaldehyde, for example. We know that we could make building materials that are very resistant. And there is just an imagination that sets the border for what we could do with this. So we are very open to everyone who wants to commit research with algae biomass, open up this research and introduce them to the algae biomass. And more of the scientists here at KTH are getting more and more interested in algae biomass and to see what we could do with it in the future. After that, we will have a residual because we have this biorefinery, and the residual, we need to do something with it. And algae, like the kelp we are cultivating, are very rich in sugars. It's very energy rich. And that means that we could get out ethanol if we want in the production. That it's more rich in sugar than sugar cane. But in this case, we are extracting biogas out from the residuals from the biorefinery. So we get biogas, and we have been counting on this, and we get enough energy to sort of run the process itself. And that means that we have an energy balance here and that it's carbon dioxide neutral. Anyway, even when you have got out the biogas, there will still maybe some nutrients in the residuals from the biogas. And there you could use it for biofertilizers, for example, and put on the agricultural fields. And algae are very good to put on the agricultural fields because you will introduce not only nitrogen and phosphorus, but you will also get an array of micronutrients that could enrich the soils and make the vegetables, for example, that you cultivate more rich and healthier food. And this is a very important thing. And I think that biofertilizers in the future from algae, for example, will be very important because there is also a deficit in phosphorus that will vanish eventually because we are using a lot of that. Eventually, everything leaks out into the environment, and that will also come from our process here, and it will come back out in the sea and cause eutrophication and overload of nutrients. But this is handling by that we are cultivating the algae, so the algae are using this, so it's also not contributing to the eutrophications of the sea. So the algae cultivation in itself is also good for the environment because it's taking up nitrogen and phosphorus. And in our waters in Sweden, we have very much nutrients in the water, and that is an environmental problem. But with algae cultivation along our coast, there is a good possibility that it would help, at least on a local scale, the marine environment. Another thing that is very valuable with the algae cultivation itself is that it attracts fish, and it could attract with the anchors, the concrete anchors that we have for our rigs on the bottom, it could attract crustaceans like lobster and crabs and things like that. So the algae cultivating site will be like a natural reserve that also stimulate the biodiversity in the area. So this could also be a very valuable thing. So the algae cultivation itself is a part of an ecosystem service. So we are helping nature by cultivating algae in the sea. And then finally, we have the focus area number 5, and that's what we are doing in my research group at our department. And we are looking into the sustainability aspects of this. We are going into the whole process chain from cultivation until the biogas, the whole chain, and we validate this from where are the technological constraints here? What is the socio-economical aspects? Could this be a valuable thing for Sweden in the future? Could this be a new industry? We are looking in, is there any environmental impacts of algae farming? And what is the potential for Sweden? How much area could we use of our seas to cultivate algae? So we do this type of calculations with the help of life cycle analysis and socio-economical analysis, cost-benefit analysis and things like that. And the thing is that the results shows that we have a great potential in Sweden. We have nice waters for this. We have a production that is very good. And we don't need to fertilize this in any way. So when we put this algae out in the water, they could just grow there. They are using the nutrients in the water. You don't need to irrigate anything. So it's climate smart to cultivate the algae. And it doesn't have any harmful effect on the environment. We haven't seen any of that, as you could see with a fish farm or a mussel farm or something like that. So the conclusion here is that this is very good for the environment, doesn't have any harm for the environment, and there is a potential of a billion dollar industry in Sweden in the future if we get this going with algae. So what could you do then? Now I've been talking about the biorefinery, that is an integrated biorefinery, because Sweden is a high-cost country, so we need to get as much profit out as possible from every step in this chain. And one of the first and lowest hanging fruits is, of course, to make it as a food, because there you could get a good price for it, and there is a huge interest in algae food. Now, this comes from the Asian cuisine, and the people in Sweden are very curious on this, and there is also a big demand from vegetarian people. And just to give a figure, in Germany, there are 16 million people that are vegetarian, 16 million people. And algae contains all the valuable lipids, proteins, minerals that need. It's a full food, you could say. So this is a very good food for vegetarian people. We are now introducing algae in the kitchens of Swedish restaurants, especially here in Stockholm. There is a very, very big interest. Last year we had algae from our farm served at the Nobel lunches here in Stockholm. So the food issues and eating them directly. And you could do so much things here. You could make caviar out of the algae. You could make, you could put it into the food. There are so many versions that you could use the algae for, different types of meals, etc. And this is also part of innovation, because if you have some good ideas here, you could earn a lot of money on getting a good recipe out on the market. This is the algae that we are cultivating. This is called sugar kelp. We are not working with any alien species or something like that. We are just using what, as we say, the population that is already there naturally. And that's where we just take them up and we, and on the laboratory, we put small spores on ropes, since thin ropes that we then deploy into the sea on bigger ropes. So we're just making hanging gardens of kelp in our waters. And that is the same species that we already have there. So we are always working with the local population when we do this work. And this is just to show that this is from the Swedish west coast, the sugar kelp, Saccharina latissima. We have done our first harvest in the SEAFARM project. We have now the first cultivation in the Marine National Park of Koster. And the first harvest was very successful. And we had more like 15 kilos of algae per meter rope, and this is a very high production. And the nice thing is that we are just utilizing the nutrients that we have in our seas. So after we have deployed these ropes into to the cultivation site, we don't need to do anything, and we wait. When we deploy them, they are only 4 or 5 millimeters, and then after 6 months they are 2 meters in length, so this grows extremely fast. And then you could make the first harvest in April, May. And we deploy them right now, October, November. And then April, May, we make the first harvest. And this is, of course, a very attractive thing, because you don't, I mean, you get the investment back after a very short while. Other things could take many years before you get the investment back. So therefore, the kelp here, the sugar kelp, is very attractive. And this is just partners in the project that is looking on the first harvest we did in the SEAFARM project. Well, we are not only working with brown algae and kelps. We are also working with other types of algae. And this is a green algae. And it's called sea salad or ulva laktuka. And these are also very good. You could do other things with them. You could use them for food. And you could also work with red algae. So we are also trying different other species and cultivate them. Some of them we are cultivating in the sea, you could do that, but others could also be cultivated in-house, in tanks. And this is attractive, especially for the food market, because then you will have a continuously cultivation that you could always provide fresh algae all year round. And we are doing that also with the sugar kelp. And that means that for restaurants and so on, we could always have fresh algae. But are we going to use the algae for more industrial scales, bio-based materials like plastics, adhesives and things like that? We need to have these big cultivation sites out in the sea to get big biomass. But for food, you could also cultivate them in tanks on land. Just showing a little bit of the other algaes that we have. We have many algaes on the Swedish west coast that are really good. And here is another one. It's very long. It's about 2 meters long. It's called cordafilum in the Latin name for it. It's really good. You could use it directly, just eat it. And especially if you're out for a long journey, canoeing or something on the west coast, you could just easily harvest it and eat it directly. Very rich in vitamins, for example. So the algae are good for us as food. And there are a lot of studies in Sweden. We haven't done this before because we don't have a tide. And that means that to get down to the algae, you have to snorkel or dive. But in many areas, in coastal areas where you have a tide, you could easily just walk out when the tide is low and catch the algae, like you're picking berries or something like that on land. And there is quite recently now theories that humans, when we started to become humans in Africa once upon a time, you have had the theory that the people were eating mussels and shellfish in order to stimulate the brain and make it grow, and we became intelligent. And we need all these fatty acids that you could find in shellfish and fish and so on. But probably they were also eating a lot of algae. So the reason for us being human could actually be that we were eating algae once upon a time in the coastal communities and starting to eat this algae. So algae are a part of our diet. And in some countries like Japan, for example, and Asia, where they have been eating algae for a long time, for example, in Okinawa, the people there, they have a special gut flora in their stomach that helps to break down the algae and utilizing the nutrients even more efficient than we can do others. So they have adapted to a diet based on algae. And that is, of course, very interesting. On Okinawa in Japan, they also become over 100 years. So maybe you could have some conclusion there that eat algae, you will be smart and you will be old. So that could be interesting. Anyway, I'm getting close to the end of my talk here. And if you want to follow the SEAFARM project, you could find this on seafarm.se. And you could learn more about what's happening in the project and all the publications that the project is generating now. We have been working for 4 years, the project. It will go on for another year. But we also get a lot of additional projects. So the algae research here in Sweden have just started and now are under, will develop. And the thing is that already there is spin-off companies now being created that wants to cultivate algae. So I'm quite convinced in just a few years here there will be a start of an algae industry, and it will start on the Swedish west coast. But there is also possibilities to develop cultivation of algae in the Baltic Sea, but we haven't started there yet. We have gone for the, as we say, lowest hanging fruits, and it's more easy to do it on the west coast, on the Atlantic coast, because it's more higher salinity and better, more species of algae to select. But that's it. So thank you very much for your attention.